The psalmist sings, "One thing I ask the Lord, that I will seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire God's temple." Siblings in Christ, God is good, and in love and mercy greets us here.
The glory of these 40 days we celebrate with songs of praise for Christ, by whom all things were made, himself has fasted and has prayed. Alone and fasting, Moses saw the loving God who gave the law, and to Elijah fasting came, the steeds and chariots of flame. So Daniel trained his mystic sight, delivered from the lion's mind, and John the Savior's friend became the herald of Messiah's name. Then grant, O God, that we may to return in fast and prayer to you, our spirit strengthened with your grace, and give us joy to see your face. And give us joy to see your
throughout the entire year. This is the moment in our worship when we name our sin together as a communal act of confession and repentance. But during Lent, this act becomes even more profound for us as Christians. As we approach the crucifixion on Good Friday and the resurrection on Easter morning, we remember that we are all lost, all finding our way back to God, opening ourselves up to the possibility of being found and fully embracing our new life. Join me in prayer. God of Jerusalem, as we journey with Jesus towards that holy city of Israel this Lent, we become aware of our humanity, our fears, our brokenness. We cry out to you for mercy. We wait for your grace, and we struggle to change our hearts and our lives again. God, hear our confession. Forgive us for taking false comfort in our relative righteousness. We gaze upon the sins of others and quietly think to ourselves, "I may have made some mistakes, but thank God I'm not like them. I'm a good person." Humble us, O God, and forgive us for failing to see that we all fall short of the love you have called us to share. God, forgive us for running away from conflict. We're more worried about our own safety and comfort, more worried about protecting what we have than we are about completing the work you have called us to. Embolden us, O God, and forgive us for protecting our own priorities over the proclamation of the gospel. Forgive us for leaving the vulnerable to fend for themselves. We have allowed them to be abused, taken advantage of. We may offer them our prayers and even our charity, but how little we've done to transform our society so that they may be truly raised up. Fill us with active compassion, O God, and forgive us for sending thoughts and prayers instead of praying our way into action. God of the cross, change our hearts and our lives. Give us the courage to follow Jesus into the thick of it. Make us bold to risk everything for the sake of your people and the truth of the gospel. And by your grace, gather us like chicks under your wing, comforted by the sure knowledge that where we go, you go with us. The grace of God has no limits, no boundaries, no borders. Hear the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. You have been made a new creation in Christ. Amen. Now, having been reminded of the mercy we've received from God, open yourself to the peace that God wants to give you in this moment. And now let's share that peace with each other by voice, by text, by whatever means. The peace of Christ be with you.
Almighty God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, open your word and illuminate our darkened world, that we may see clearly and live faithfully by the light of your truth in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our first scripture reading for this morning is the 122nd Psalm. Listen for God's holy word. I rejoiced with those who said to me, "Let's go to the Lord's house." Now our feet are standing in your gates, Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built like a city joined together in unity. That is where the tribes go up, the Lord's tribes. It is the law of Israel to give thanks there to the Lord's name, because the thrones of justice are there, the thrones of the house of David. Pray that Jerusalem has peace. Let those who love you have rest. Let there be peace on your walls. Let there be rest on your fortifications. For the sake of my family and friends, I say, peace be with you, Jerusalem. For the sake of the Lord, our God's house, I will pray for your good. Friends, the flower fades and the grass withers, but God's word endures forever.
Mother God, your wings are all. till our strong heart sings. May we enfold our sisters and our brothers till all are strong, till all have eagle's wings.
Our second reading of scripture for this morning is taken from the 13th chapter of Luke, verses 1 to 9 and 31 to 35. Listen once again for God's holy word. Some who were present on that occasion told Jesus about the Galileans whom Pilate had killed when they were offering sacrifices. He replied, "Do you think the suffering of these Galileans proves that they were more sinful than all the other Galileans? No, I tell you. But unless you change your hearts and your lives, you will die as they did." Well, what about the 18 people who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them? Do you think they were more guilty of wrongdoing than everyone else in all of Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you change your hearts and lives, you will die as they did. Then Jesus told them a parable. A man owned a fig tree planted in the vineyard. He came looking for fruit and found none. He said to his gardener, "Look, I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree for the past 3 years, and I've never found any. Cut it down. Why should it continue depleting the soil's nutrients?" The gardener responded, "Lord, give it just one more year, and I will dig around it and give it fertilizer. Maybe it will produce fruit next year. If not, then cut it down." Now, at that time, some Pharisees approached Jesus and said, "Go, get away from here because Herod wants to kill you." Jesus said to them, "You go tell that fox, 'Look, I'm throwing out demons and healing people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will complete my work. However, it's necessary for me to travel today and tomorrow and the next day, because it's impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem.'" Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those who were sent to you, how often I have wanted to gather your people as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. But you didn't want that. Look, your house is abandoned. I tell you, you won't see me until the time comes when you say, 'Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Have you ever had firsthand experience with the fight or flight reaction? Maybe a car swerved in front of you on the highway, or a vicious looking dog seemed to be moments away from breaking free of a leash and coming at you while you're on your morning walk. Or maybe you turn a corner in your darkened house and see the shape of a person standing near your door, only to realize that it's just your jacket hanging on a hook. The fight or flight response is a human response driven from our sympathetic nerve system. This response is our body's reaction to danger, and it was designed in our DNA to help us survive stressful and life-threatening situations. During a fight or flight response, hormones rush through our bodies, either prompting us to stay and fight or to run away and flee. During the response, all bodily systems are working to keep us alive in what we have perceived as a dangerous situation. I have seen my daughter wage an internal war against her fight or flight response while being prepped for a vaccination at the doctor's office. I have also sat with jelly legs in my car after a near collision left me rattled. Our body was designed to help us survive stressful and life-threatening situations. In our passage from Luke's gospel, the Pharisees explain to Jesus that he is in real, physical, imminent danger. These religious leaders go to Jesus and warn him to go, get away from here, because Herod wants to kill you. This is no minor threat. Remember, Herod is, after all, the one who executed Jesus' cousin, John the Baptist. He beheaded him and put his head on a silver platter. This Herod had every opportunity and every power to fulfill his threat to kill Jesus. One might expect Jesus to take the hint and hightail it out of there. However, Jesus is not on a journey to get away from it all. He is on a journey to get into it all, specifically into the midst of Jerusalem, into the heart of the people of God, even when they are determined to destroy him. Jesus has been traveling through Galilee, casting out demons, preaching in the synagogues, healing the blind and the lame, stilling storms, dining with opponents, and teaching parables. Not long before this passage in narrative time, Jesus set his face to go to Jerusalem, and now he is determined to meet that goal. Jesus doesn't flee, because he has another plan in mind altogether. It was interesting to me in reading this passage this week that it was the Pharisees who warned Jesus to flee from Herod. After all, the Pharisees are the bad guys of the gospel, the ones who question and mock and hate Jesus. They're legalistic, oppressive, they're religious authorities who are always out to get Jesus, because he violated the Torah. So why were they now warning Jesus and trying to save his life? Well, Luke's portrayal of the Pharisees was much more nuanced than that of the other gospel writers. The Pharisees definitely raised questions about Jesus' ministry and his interpretation of the scriptures. But Luke paints a picture of Pharisees who were also genuinely interested in learning from Jesus, traveling a great distance to see him. In Luke's gospel, Pharisees debated Jesus just as they would debate amongst themselves. At times, Pharisees offered hospitality to Jesus, inviting him to dine in their homes. However, they also criticized Jesus' choice of dinner companions. Jesus responds to their questions, but not always in ways that they welcomed. Some Pharisees were openly hostile, trying to trap him. Jesus in Luke critiques the Pharisees for their hypocrisy, their neglect of justice and love of God, their desire to receive honor and recognition, and their love of money. An honest listener of Luke's portrayal of the Pharisees will recognize similar characteristics in themselves. I know that I do, the good and the bad. But the Pharisees warn Jesus to flee from the threat of Herod. But Jesus does not flee. Instead, he states that he must be on his way and that it is impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem. This suggests that neither Pharisees nor Herod can interfere with this divine plan. Jesus cannot flee from the coming days, so he continues the work that he set out to do. Jesus is busy. He's casting out demons and healing people. He has work to do. He explains that he has a 3-day plan and Herod doesn't fit into it. If Jesus heeds the Pharisees' warning, he is likely to be seen as a chicken-hearted prophet who claims to do God's work but then disappears at the first sign of trouble. Instead, Jesus takes a different approach on being chicken-hearted. Jesus uses the image of a hen, a mother hen, to explain why he doesn't flee, but instead will choose to stay to fight, to shelter, to protect, and ultimately to save. I love this imagery of Christ as a mother hen. I love that it flies in the face of so many Old Testament images of who the Messiah would be. A lion who uses strength to intimidate and crush enemies with a single blow. A military savior king who promises safety and security in the face of border incursions and terrorist attacks. Or an eagle, a spiritual hero who soars above earthly dreariness, carrying followers to mountaintops of ecstatic experience. Or a bear, a powerful prophetic savior who charges in to critique a culture that has lost sight of God. No. Jesus thinks about this threat from Herod, looks over the people that he is healing and loving, and he laments over the city of Jerusalem, and he names a very different kind of savior, a mother hen. A mother hen who loves her chicks so fiercely that she offers them shelter beneath her own wings, leaving herself open for attack. And when the fox prowls, as they always do, the chicks are not left to fight for themselves. The hen fights on their behalf, putting her life on the line to save them. Mother hens in real life swell with indignation and fear and courage when they are protecting their young and in immediate threat. They stand their ground. They prepare to die if they have to, their children tucked securely beneath their soft, vulnerable bodies. I cannot imagine a more profound or radical picture of our Savior. What is it like to have a mother hen for a savior? What is it like to be baby chicks in the face of a cosmic battle involving powers that kill? For many, I can imagine that it is tempting to ally with the fox, or at least to call for a farmer and a shotgun to take care of the fox problem. But that's not the way of God. It is crowded beneath these wings, given that God keeps inviting others into God's barnyard kingdom. But still, the hen stays in the barnyard with all of them. When the fox comes, she is there, puffed up with indignation, fear, and the ultimate courage. She's not the savior that we imagined, but the savior that we need. In Lent, there is so much conversation about death. And death is what happens when the foxes go after the chickens. But the ultimate message of Lent is that death is not the final word, nor is it the end of the story. There is no need to run away. There's no need to get away from it all because Jesus is present in the midst of it all. There is no need to flee because Jesus is sheltering, holding his people, and ready to die for us. When we live in the truth and the promise of Christ's power, of Christ's resurrection promise, we sit in the shelter of those wings, knowing that the fox could not scare Jesus away. The cross could not scare Jesus away. And we have the gift of eternal life because of that courage. And thanks be to God for that. Amen.
I believe.
I believe.
I enlist.
I believe in God.
Father Almighty.
Maker of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ.
Who was conceived by the Holy Spirit.
Born of the Virgin Mary.
He suffered under Pontius Pilate.
He descended to hell.
The third day.
He arose from the dead.
He ascended into heaven.
Seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty.
From there he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
I believe in the Holy Spirit.
I did cure.
Look at my saint.
The forgiveness of sins.
The resurrection of the body.
And the life everlasting.
Amen.
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 And now we invite you to stand in body or in spirit and join your voice, whatever it looks or sounds like, as we declare this together.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
It is so good to have you with us in this service of Christian worship today. We encourage you to let us know that you've been with us. You can not only sign in through our friendship ritual, but in that same place, let us know of any prayer requests or if any of us on the pastoral team can be in contact to have a conversation with you. You can go to that link through our homepage, and I hope that we'll get better acquainted through that. Also, following worship today on the Zoom platform, we have 30 good minutes of fellowship So I encourage you to check your parish life email to find the link so that you can join in that good time of sharing and prayer with other believers from our congregation. Next Sunday, we will continue our in-person service of worship here in the sanctuary. It is one that requires registration because we are taking steps to make sure that we are socially distanced and safe with one another. I encourage you to go to the website. The registration will open at noon today for next Sunday's worship. We look forward to having those of you who feel safe and able to join us for that. And of course, we will continue to have online services available for the congregation. In addition, we are going through this season of Lent together, this time of lost and found, according to the amazing grace of our Savior. We're looking at our understanding of salvation together with other churches around the Chicagoland area in a ministry that our own Ryan Wallace and his Faith Formation team have been at the forefront of pioneering. I'll be teaching one of those sessions. They meet on Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings. And again, go to the website and you'll be able to learn more about it there. Finally, I want to lift up the fact that we have our virtual trivia night soon around the corner. In just a minute, I'm going to invite you to hear a word from Bill Skeens about that. But before I turn to him, I invite each one of us to think about the way that we are offering our hearts unto God. You know, there are ways that we can apply ourselves through a life of service and prayer and study, through the worship that we share, through the gifts that we offer with our time, our talent, and our treasure. In the midst of Christian worship, there is this opportunity to respond to the Word of God with grateful lives. And so I invite you into this walk of discipleship. Hear about this fun one way that you can join in that through our virtual trivia night, and then let your heart meditate upon the gift of living in gratitude as we share in some music following Bill's announcement. Well, here's a word from Bill Skeens.
Good morning, I'm Bill Skeens. Some of the things that I love about the good people of First Presbyterian Church of Libertyville is your generous heart, your willingness to support others less fortunate, and we love to have fun. 4 years ago, we started a great tradition with Trivia Night and helping local Lake County charities. I've got great news for you. We're doing it again this year, only it'll be slightly different, as this year, instead of being live, Trivia Night will be virtual. Last year, we raised over $40,000 to help Lake County charities such as Erie Health, Habitat for Humanities, A Safe Place, Love Inc., and PADS, just to name a few. This year, we hope to raise, are you ready for this? $50,000. But we need your help. Here are a few details of our March Mission Madness. Virtual Trivia Night is on Friday, March 12th at 7:30. Similar to last year, we will have trivia teams competing, and your teams can literally be friends and family from around the world. Put together a team of 10 people and have them register individually. If you don't have a team, you'll be assigned one. It will be so much fun. Tickets are $20 each. Pizzeria DeVille is also offering a pizza kit for pickup Friday afternoon, so you can prepare and have a great meal and a fun party. Pizzeria DeVille is also donating $10 per kit to Trivia Night. Now, how cool is that? A bit cheesy, but really cool. We are having an incredible silent auction featuring 50, yes, 50 amazing and unique items, services, and experiences. For example, the Townlanders have offered their beautiful barn for you to have your own party for 50 people post-COVID. How about a week's stay in a vacation home to watch the fall colors in Maine offered by the Davises, or a great home in Crested Butte, Colorado by Nancy and Mike Roach? We also have lessons, musical performances, gift baskets, and weekend getaways. Remember, you do not have to attend trivia night to bid on the silent auction items. Finally, you can also make a donation outright that is 100% tax deductible. And rumor has it there's a matching opportunity to stretch your gift even further. So what do you need to do now? Buy your virtual tickets and pizza kit on the church website now. There will be a link and you can bid and donate starting tomorrow on the silent auction site. Coming out of COVID, we all need some fun, and nothing is better than this March mission madness. Thank you for your time and for your generous hearts, and we look forward to seeing you online.
Won't you join your heart together with mine in prayer? Let us pray. O God, we set upon a path following you out of deep gratitude for the way in which your love has touched our lives. We give you thanks, O God, for the people who have demonstrated care and compassion for us, for those who have demonstrated wisdom and helped to guide us along the way of life. We offer thanks, O God, for the simple gifts of life, for the beauty and nature, for the prospect of spring, for the way in which you are with us through every change and challenge of our journey. And we give thanks to you, O God, for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Like the disciples, we have encountered his teaching, and inspired by what he proposes We seek to follow after him. We must confess there are days we are unaware of what following in the footsteps of our Savior may bring to our lives. Fortify us with courage and faith through such changing and challenging days as the ones in which we find ourselves living. Grant, O God, that we would understand the responsibility of taking up our cross daily to follow after Jesus, of living lives that bear good fruit, of love, care, of peace, justice, righteousness, compassion. We pray for our community, O God, for Lake County, for Libertyville itself, for neighboring communities. We ask, O God, that you would help us to reflect carefully upon important choices we need to make for the well-being of all. Help us to see our community, our patterns of living together, through the eyes, the compassionate and just eyes of our Savior, and help us bear fruit. We pray, O God, for the health and well-being of our frontline workers, and for all who are facing challenges of health. Today, O God, especially, we find ourselves praying for those who are waiting on their vaccine, for all of us who are longing for a better day. O God, be at work amongst us and give us faith and fruitfulness in our living. We pay attention to those who have been near to our heart, those in our congregation about whom we have concern. O God, hear our prayers in a moment of silence now. Now lead us on, O Christ, as we walk in your footsteps, remembering the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We'll be right back.
Friends, what does it mean to you to be held in the safety of the wings of a mother hen? Know that Christ is with you. As we journey through these days in Lent, we cannot be lost, for we are found in the warmth of God's great barnyard. So now receive this benediction. May the God of hope fill you with all peace and joy in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.